Thank you. Okay, it is on. I think I'm going to stand on this side because there seems to be some funkiness with that. Thank you, Mike. And you know, Mike is always too humble. He gets up here and says he's just here to set the table for the real presenters. He's a tough act to follow. Thank you, Mike. Thanks for setting the bar so high. But I should say, I do want to start off by thanking the organizers of this event. It really is such an honor and a privilege to be here and be part of this conversation. And really such a great opportunity to come back to Oporto, which is one of my favorite cities, and see friends that I don't get to see as often as I wish I could. But I've been asked to kind of talk about how Rabobank sees this issue of climate change and sustainability, talk a little bit about why a financial institution cares about climate change, talk about then maybe a little bit what we see, some of the important initiatives we see our clients taking, and then maybe a couple of initiatives that we're taking as we kind of look at this. But starting with why does a financial institution care about climate change and sustainability issues, for those of you that don't know Rabobank, it's a Dutch bank, started a little over 100 years ago as a savings and loan co-op for small farmers in the Netherlands. And it's grown over the past 100 years to become this a financial institution with global reach, but still very focused. Our bread and butter is in the agricultural industry, the food and agricultural industry. We have clients around the world in the beverage industry, and we are particularly close to the wine industry, one of the largest lenders to the wine industry internationally. So for us, we look at this issue of climate change as an issue of understanding and getting our arms around risk. And you know, for the last 10 years, I would say our view on this has changed. This went from being something that we kind of read about and thought of as a theoretical risk to something that's really become top of mind. And you know, a great example is California, where we've seen in the past 5 years issues of severe drought that's kind of decimated reservoirs of water, created some threats of wildfires, and then go from that to extreme flooding, both creating problems. And this for us is an issue of risk with our producers. But even then, you know, for our producers that were able to mitigate risk during times of drought by increasing irrigation, for us in some ways, you know, you look at that really becomes a way of mitigating short-term risk by exacerbating the long-term risk, because we've been depleting our aquifers in California at a really alarming rate, to the point where, you know, if you go out to parts of California, you can actually see land subsidence because the aquifers have been depleted so much. So this becomes a long-term issue. It's becoming an issue that has really driven change in the way farmers think about farming practices and investing in the sector, and it's something that we need to get our arms around. So one of the things that I wanted to highlight and talk about, one interesting example of what you know we see happening with our clients, measures that they're taking. One example, kind of highlight one example, is kind of what we see with Jackson Family Wines, and for a specific reason. And there are clearly 100 examples. Everyone in this room is here because we take this issue seriously, and there are measures and initiatives that we could highlight, but I did want to highlight one thing. Jackson Family Wines, an important client of ours, a couple of years ago we gave them an award that we give out every year, the Leadership and Excellence Award, and the reason we gave it out was really around their initiatives in sustainability. And you know, we can talk about the specific targets that they set for reduction in greenhouse gases, for reducing water use, and et cetera, and all of those are important. But what I really wanted to highlight was not just the initiatives that they're taking, but the fact, and I think you'll probably touch on this, the fact that they are incorporating those goals and those targets into the targets for senior management. And so for senior management to hit their targets, and this is tied to compensation, hitting your compensation really is tied to not just hitting your sales and marketing revenue, not just profitability issues, but really tying your sustainability goals into the metrics that you use to gauge the success of top management. And I think that's a critical issue for us to be thinking about. And then maybe just, you know, a brief discussion on some of the things that we're doing, because we really do take this issue seriously. And this is not an attempt to pat ourselves on the back, but we were ranked recently number one by Sustainalytics among banks for hitting environmental, social governance goals and so forth. We do take this seriously. We have, and that's been a severe improvement because we've really stepped up our game on this issue. And the way that we look at this is, you know, when we think about sustainability, this really drives how we think about which sectors we're going to invest in. We've walked away from lending into certain sectors because of sustainability issues. We think about this when we kind of onboard clients and we look at their sustainability measures. And these are conversations, ongoing conversations that we have with our clients and saying, look, these are issues that need to be addressed here. Here's how you stack up against some of your competitors and areas where we think that you could improve and to try to have some of those conversations. But one of the things that I think has been really interesting for us is, you know, initiative that we're putting a lot of emphasis on and investment behind is something that we call Banking for Food. And this is kind of a thought, a recognition that we do have this challenge ahead of us as an agricultural industry and as a global population, that we need to feed a rising population with very limited resources and increased risk and volatility from climate change. And this is, you know, this is the challenge before us. This is a challenge for our clients, and this is a challenge for the bank. And we have a number of different initiatives within the Banking for Food initiative. But one that I really wanted to highlight today was Food Bites, and try to keep this limited. Food Bites is basically, it's an initiative that starts from the recognition that both the bank and our clients recognize that we need new strategies. We need new technology to address the challenges that we're facing today. But we also recognize that that technology and some of these ideas need to come from the outside. At the same time, we recognize if you look out, there is such an evolving and an interesting ecosystem of entrepreneurs that are coming on board, that are out there today, that are coming up with really creative solutions to some of the problems around climate change and sustainability. But they lack access to financial capital, they lack scale, and they lack investment. And so what we're doing is we're going out and bringing in ideas from some of these startups. Some of these are really just in the idea phase. Some of these are startup companies, and they're coming to us and they're saying, hey, we would like to pitch these ideas. We'll go through a screening process, and we're putting on a series of events, about 6 or 7 events a year, in London, in New York, in San Francisco. We're bringing in 15 or 20 of these really interesting companies to do a 5-minute elevator pitch to investors, to private equity, and to a lot of our corporate clients. And it's a chance for them to say, here's an idea that we would like to grow. Here's an idea. We are a startup company. We are doing X, Y, and Z. Always with a sustainability focus. And so among the companies that have come through, we've had companies that are using technology to reduce food waste. We have companies that are looking for ways to use beneficial nematodes to increase productivity. We've had companies come through with technology around using sensors to increase productivity in agriculture, using robots to do weeding instead of using herbicides and so forth. So there's a series of interesting kind of companies that are coming through, and it's a way for us to bring together creative new ideas with the companies that are searching from the companies that have the route to market and the distribution strength and the financial capital to take these ideas to market. One of the companies, how am I doing on time? I'm okay. And I'll just wrap up. I'm okay. So that means shut up. Yeah, okay. The last point. One of the companies that's come through, a company called Biomakers. This is just an example. I think, Paul, you know these guys. This is a Spanish company. This is a company that's using artificial intelligence and DNA sequencing technology to map out microbiology of soil. I mean, it's the geekiest thing ever, but what it's allowing What it's allowing farmers to do is to do really personalized agriculture, really understand what the impact of your farming practices on the soil, and also kind of what your soil, how your soil can ultimately determine, in the case of wine, the quality of your wine. And this is, you know, this is allowing us to make smarter decisions, more sustainable decisions around production and ultimately winemaking, because this is at the heart of winemaking. This is part of the core of what is terroir. With that, I should just really wrap up. I do work for a bank. We have a ton of lawyers, so they make me tell you that this is just my opinion. If you take anything I say, take it with a grain of salt, because I'm an idiot. And I will pass this over to you, Mike.
Thank you, Stephen. You.